Good morning and welcome to That's My Farm. I'm Michaela DeMott, your guest host, and I'm here in Chase, Kansas, talking with Doug Keesling about his crops, his livestock, and his advocacy for agriculture. Stay tuned and we'll be right back after these messages from our sponsors.
Closed captioning brought to you by Ag Promo Source. Together we grow. Learn more at agpromosource.com.
That's My Farm. It's brought to you in part by Tall Grass Commodities. Big enough to serve, small enough to care.
Good morning and welcome to That's My Farm. I'm Michaela DeMott, your guest host, and I'm here in Chase, America with Doug Keesling. First off, Doug, tell me a little bit about the operation you have here.
All right, Keesling Farms here was once Keesling Seed Farms under my dad and my grandfather. I'm the fifth generation to run and live here at this facility. And we have a wheat, corn, soybean, milo, and cattle operation here on the Santa Fe Trail.
Okay, and then tell me a little bit, I know this farm has a unique history. Tell me a little bit about the history of the farm.
Yeah, there was a doctor who actually homesteaded right here at this location and would treat settlers as they were coming by on the Santa Fe Trail. Mm-hmm. So he had a unique position because we find different plants and stuff here that he used as medicine. We also have a cemetery in our pasture from some of the mistakes of his practice, I guess you could say, or the people who did not make it out here. You think about the hard times that we go through sometimes and what we complain about, mm-hmm. but the settlers had it a lot harder than what we've ever had it. So.
Sure. Talk a little bit about, I know you have crops and cattle here, talk a little bit about that.
Okay, we raise a lot of wheat in rotation with corn and beans and milo and soybeans. This year, the last couple years has been interesting because we've gone from a drought to this year kind of a wet time. So we had tremendous yields on our wheat this year with prices being down, but ended up kind of being about the same as mm-hmm. in the past years. But it's interesting to have those good crops, and we're harvesting corn right now, mm-hmm. and those yields are way up. So
great. And I know you kind of have an interesting story about how you got back to the family farm. So tell me a little bit about your history of coming back to the farm.
Sure. When I was in high school, I didn't want anything to do with the farm. Everything it seemed like that I did with my parents, I was bound and determined I was going to leave.
Sure.
And so ended up going to school for botany and then ended up switching to journalism. Went to California for a while and took a job out there. And then with my mom getting sick with cancer, came mm-hmm. back to help, and I've never left since. But it's been an interesting road because I do a lot of ag advocacy, and the journalism degree that I have has been able to help mm-hmm. me promote, you know, the love of agriculture to the world.
How has the transition from generation to generation been here at the farm?
Actually, ours has been very smooth. I know some farm families, that's a struggle. I'm the fifth generation, and we're already planning for our sixth generations. I have four children, mm-hmm. and I'm wanting to go ahead and try to help them get set up where they can have a future forward. But we've been able to do this fairly well. My dad decided to retire 5 years ago, and when he did, he went to pursue some other interests, and I kind of took over full time. But prior to that, we have several businesses here, and he's just kind of started turning me loose with one business at a time and was able to kind of help that transition then as I could grow and learn about those different entities.
Sure. We will be right back after these messages from our sponsors.
Buying a car shouldn't be this hard. And at Brown Chevrolet Buick in Wamego, it isn't. It's actually awesome. Whether you want a new or used car or truck, Toby's team can make the deal. Even if you want to custom order a new car or truck, Toby's team can make the deal. See Toby's team at Brown Chevrolet Buick in Wamego. We're awesome.
Soil is the life of a farm, and for 25 years, SureCrop Liquid Crop Nutrition has helped growers produce abundant quality crops while preserving and improving the soils they steward. SureCrop offers complete soil and plant analysis with cropping recommendations, delivery direct to your on-farm storage, and quality crop nutrition custom blended for your field. Choose SureCrop for the assurance of excellence for your soil. Call today or visit their website for more information.
When your living depends on agriculture, you can depend on KFRM 550 AM. If you're in the southwest three-fourths of Kansas or the northern half of Oklahoma, catch us at 5:50 a.m. on the radio dial. But if that isn't you, listen on your cell phone at TuneIn Radio or on your computer at KFRM.com. We promise to keep you informed, entertained, and company as you go through your day. KFRM 5:50 a.m., the voice of the Plains, we would like to join your management team.
Support Kansas agriculture education with an AgriTag. AgriTags are available anytime at your county treasurer. They look great on cars and trucks. For more information, go online to ksagclassroom.org.
That's My Farm is brought to you in part by Tallgrass Commodities. Big enough to serve, small enough to care.
Good morning and welcome back to That's My Farm. I'm Michaela DeMott, your guest host, and I am here with Doug in front of his cornfield and on some conservation land. And tell me a little bit about how you use your conservation here on the farm.
Sure, we're standing in a CP33. It's filter strips that go all the way around our farms. Mm-hmm. The majority of our pieces of land have these. Okay. They work for multiple purposes. One, they clean up, this farm has lots of terraces, mm-hmm. so it cleans up any water coming in and out of mm-hmm. the farm, so that we're doing a better job with the environment and all of this. Also, this is perfect hunting grounds and nesting grounds mm-hmm. for pheasants, upland birds, quail, turkey. The deer love to lay in here. Mm-hmm. So, you know, with four children and I enjoy to hunt, it's nice to be able to come out here on a weekend, mm-hmm. spend time with your family and your kids to be able to go hunting. Mm-hmm. And then also, we also bring other people out, and when we're educating them about farm and farm life, a lot of times hunting comes up because it's something that they'll do. Mm-hmm. So we like to bring them out here and we'll walk these strips mm-hmm. and to be able to do this. So I guide pheasant and quail hunts also in order to do this. And, you know, also we do this as something that we can give back to the community. Mm-hmm. My son was in the hospital a little bit. Children's Mercy treated him so well in Kansas City mm-hmm. that I donate hunts either to Children's Mercy or St. Jude's. And it's something that I can give back to the community by donating pheasant hunts and then guide those hunts mm-hmm. back to the community too.
Okay, so great. So we're here in front of your cornfield. So tell me a little bit about the crop and land side of things on your farm.
Sure, we got cornfield behind us. This isn't considered to be one of our most productive fields, but this year it is doing very well. It's a blow sand field with high elevation changes, as you can see, that really drops off behind us. And this year, the corn is doing tremendous. Dry land yields, what we've cut so far, have been running 140 to 150 bushels on this, mm-hmm. which is tremendous for this piece of soil. Mm-hmm. And so we're really blessed by all of that to be able to have this good of corn on here in this mm-hmm. type of year. But we will be, after we harvest the corn, we'll be planting wheat back. So it will be no-tilled right into these stalks mm-hmm. Shortly after. Then we'll have 2 years worth of wheat on there. Then we'll go back and either double crop beans or milo back mm-hmm. into those. And then whichever we choose the opposite of those two the following year. And then it'll go back to corn, and then after the corn, then it'll go continue mm-hmm. right on in with the double crop wheat and mm-hmm. back into the rotation again.
Okay, and what are some other practices? I know you do some organic type farming here. Talk
sure.
to me about that.
All of the fertilizer we use on our crops across our whole farm is organic mm-hmm. chicken litter from an egg laying facility that's only 4 miles from this site. So we stockpile the chicken litter as it comes out every week, spread it that week in order to keep flies and insects down, and use that as a source of organic manure. Mm-hmm. It's natural, it's high in phosphorus, trace minerals, and it works perfect for the soil. Mm-hmm. And it's a way to keep not only the crops, but also our grasses going in our pastures and in these conservation reserves. Mm-hmm. And it's a natural thing so that we feel very comfortable that we're doing the right thing for the environment.
Mm-hmm. So speaking of your grasses, I know you have some unique things about some of your land here and some history to this farm here.
Sure. Almost all of the land that we farm is owned by family members. Mm-hmm. So my father, myself, I have two older sisters that each have a piece of land that they mm-hmm. keep. Even my two sons already have a piece of land that's in their name. Mm-hmm. And so this piece of dirt, my grandfather bought during the Depression for $192. He bought 160 acres here, and it was his father-in-law's. And so his father-in-law during the Depression the bank was in the process of foreclosing on this piece of dirt, and he went in and paid the loan off and got it. I'm sure that that made extra bonus points for a son-in-law to do that. So even back then, you know, I'm sure people went for bonus points. And so this was kind of an interesting piece of history. And I now own this piece of land and really enjoy the history and all that goes behind that. I believe that God only made so much land and that we need to do the right thing by it and protect it and do the right thing for our environment, because I plan on living here all my life.
Great, thank you. We'll be right back after these messages from our sponsors.
Here's another gardening tip with Annette Jackson from Jackson's Greenhouse.
Fall is a great time to plant, and if you would like fresh fruit, grapes, or berries to eat next year, now is an ideal time to plant.
We'll show you how, what, and where to plant for a successful crop of delicious, healthy fruit. We have a great selection and great service. Come see us at Jackson's.
Our entire stock of shrubs, roses, berries, perennials, and trees are now on sale at 25% off. Hurry out for your best selection.
Jackson's Greenhouse has what you need today.
Ag Promo Source is a unique group of marketing specialists with one mission: help your ag business grow. Each affiliate has their own area of expertise, and they work together to bring you advice, products, and services. To get started, visit agpromosource.com. Ag Promo Source, together we grow.
That's My Farm is brought to you in part by Tallgrass Commodities. Big enough to serve, small enough to care.
Good morning and welcome back to That's My Farm. I'm back here with Doug in front of his Red Angus herd of cattle. So Doug, why Red Angus?
Well, we several years ago we bought seven that were Red Angus Polled Hereford crosses. And then we went and bought multiple bulls that have all been purebred Red Angus. So they're getting more and more red all the time. But there's still that little bit of Polled Hereford in them. But it's funny because as you look back, as we all should in history, when my grandfather had his cattle herd, it was all dairy cattle. And when my dad graduated high school, they all disappeared off the farm because there wasn't the extra manpower to help. And so dad always complained about that. I remember hearing that growing up. But the history tends to repeat itself. So my dad bought Polled Herefords. And when I was the last child to graduate, and when I left home, all of the Polled Herefords disappeared off the farm for several years until I came back. So it's interesting, always has history does repeat itself.
So talk a little bit about what the cattle have been grazing on here. And I know you have a unique piece of land here on your farm. So talk a little bit about those things.
Sure. This one is not a native pasture here, man-made. And we're getting ready to turn them out on some cover crops. In with our crop rotation, we always pick one that's near one of our pastures and plant a mixture of sedan, any leftover milos or anything else that's left, just to clean up the warehouse. We usually mix it in with some millets, cowpeas, few other interesting things from year to year, whichever we think is might be best for that piece of ground or that year. And we plant it as a cover crop mixture. And this one's planted on the other side of the fence, and they're going to be turned out here tomorrow on it. And so that way they can graze it and continue. So that's the way we're able to keep most of the herd together or a bigger chunk of the herd together in one spot instead of rotating. And you mentioned the one native piece. We have one piece that's still native grass. And so we try to take extra care of it because you can still see the Santa Fe Trail wagon ruts through that piece. And it's really an interesting piece of history because as we go on further in time, there's less and less of those native ones. You can still see the buffalo wallers and the wagon wheel tracks. And so it's just a neat part of our family history.
Awesome, great, thank you. We'll be right back after these messages from our sponsors.
The new Better Horses Network is worldwide, presented by Lucas Oil, featuring worldwide radio and TV with iconic hosts like Al Dunning, Sharon Camarillo, Ernie Rodina, Lindy Birch, and Craig Cameron. With American Cowboy, Horse and Rider, Brushy Creek, Cavenders, and Ride TV. Worldwide radio and TV, the all-new Better Horses Network.
Valley Vet Supply is devoted to providing information and professional quality products at reasonable prices.
ValleyVet.com, Valley. Next time you see a beautiful field of corn, reach out and thank the farmers who work tirelessly to raise corn for livestock feed, renewable fuels, and exports to feed a growing world population. The farmers on the Kansas Corn Commission work for Kansas corn with grower-funded checkoff dollars that support foreign and domestic market development, research, promotion, and education to expand opportunities for Kansas farmers. To learn more, visit kscorn.com.
That's My Farm is brought to you in part by Tallgrass Commodities. Big enough to serve, small enough to care.
Good morning and welcome back to That's My Farm. I'm Michaela DeMont, your guest host here with Doug Keesling. And we're going to talk a little bit about his involvement in the Wheat Commission. So first off, talk to me about your involvement in Kansas Wheat Commission.
Sure. The Kansas Wheat Commission has helped farmers for 50-some years across Kansas, whether it be research and development, whether it be education around the world, and several other facets. Let's talk about some of that. So for every bushel of wheat that we raise here on our farm, there's 2 pennies that go to the Wheat Commission through the checkoff funds, and those funds go to promote new varieties back on our farms, new wheat research for disease and insect protection. They also go back to help go in with other funds as matching funds through the federal government to fund U.S. wheat associates across the world to promote growing markets like Latin America or Africa or things like this. They also go into promotions and education in order to educate the people, whether it be an urban market to combat celiac disease and to go to funding in order to help find a cure for something like that. All of those are important things.
Mm-hmm. So how do those private funds support that research?
They're using that through the Wheat Commission as a board. We sit down and with farmer input, we try to figure out what is the most important things for that year and that those funds can be used for. So we may have part of it maybe for developing a new wheat variety in Kansas so that we can have a new Everest or a new Canmark or any of those new varieties. And so that we, as farmers, we can raise more. It might be in order to have disease protection and stuff like this. Then it goes a step further by promoting wheat in other ways. That goes into developments of the International Grains Program, promoting it internationally by bringing in foreign trade buyers that way. It might be because we developed the Heartland Plant Innovation Center that's there in the building also. And the Heartland Plant Innovation Center has greenhouses, office space, and genetics labs where we're working on double haploids. This ties back because it helps a program like Alan Fritz's develop new wheats for Kansas in a shorter amount of time for the farmer. So it benefits that farmer.
Perfect. And how do those things benefit you here on your farm?
Oh, well, all of those, by being able for Alan to be able to develop a variety of wheat in 7 years by the use of double haploids and marker technology, rather than taking 10 plus years, gets it to my farm faster in order so that we can increase our production here on a local level.
Perfect. Great. Thank you. We'll be right back after these messages from our sponsors.
Watch Ag AM in Kansas online at agamandkansas.com.
There's a lot of different ways of doing this woodwork, but I could not make a knife without both hands, especially without this thumb. And my thumb was so sore that I couldn't even touch it. And they wanted to fuse it, and I said, no, cut it off, because I didn't want it sticking up. And I found out about the Kansas Regenerative stem cell and went to Manhattan and had that taken care of in my thumb, and now I'm able to go again.
Grain sorghum is one of the most important cereal crops worldwide, and Kansas leads the nation in its production. Over the years, sorghum has been either exported, used in animal feed domestically, or for other industrial uses. Recently, its use in the ethanol market has seen tremendous growth, with 30% of domestic sorghum typically going to ethanol production. Kansas Grain Sorghum is committed to sorghum research, market development, and education. Learn more at ksgrainsorghum.org.
That's My Farm is brought to you in part by Tallgrass Commodities. Big enough to serve, small enough to care.
Good morning and welcome back to That's My Farm. I'm Michaela DeMott, your guest host, and Doug is going to talk a little bit about his involvement outside of Kansas. So I know you're really involved in the state of Kansas. Talk to me a little bit about your involvement outside of Kansas and internationally.
Sure. When it comes to agriculture, a lot of times we cannot think just right here on this farm, in this county, and sometimes even in this state. We have to think globally. So I've been trying to work on several fronts in order to help out Kansas wheat farmers sell other products. Lately, we had a group of Cuban millers in Kansas. We showed them around, went through Kansas City with them, Topeka, Manhattan, showed them the Innovation Center that we talked about. And this helps because it helps to educate foreign buyers, whether it be from Cuba, Mexico, the Middle East, Africa, any of our major buyers, in order to help them understand how we operate and the rules and the how to write a contract in order so they get the product that they want. So that's one of some of the main things. So I've traveled a lot, whether it be to Mexico, lately several times to Cuba, in order to open free trade up there. That really affects us a huge amount in Kansas because Kansas just got done raising a bumper wheat crop. We have piles of grain on the ground in certain places around, and we're starting fall harvest. I'm starting corn harvest now, and the elevators want to move this. If we could open up the embargo to Cuba, you're talking about 10% of the wheat that's raised right here in Kansas could be shipped down to Cuba immediately and be used by people right away. They're buying right now from the European Union, from Canada. So logistics-wise, we have an advantage. So if we could open that up, sell that, then that 10% would get rid of a huge amount of stockpiles of grain here. We also work a lot with U.S. Wheat Associates over abroad, working on projects like food aid that Jerry Moran has talked about a lot in some bills that he's working on. Also, the flour fortification for Africa, because sometimes bread is some of their only staple crops that they get on a regular basis. So the end goal is to sell more U.S. ag products, and I want to sell wheat from my farm.
For sure. So you talked a little bit about education. Tell me about the work that you do in D.C. to educate, to kind of bridge the gap for agriculture.
Well, sometimes with agriculture, we have representatives that represent our individual states. We have to educate them on what that means. So we have to educate them that 10% of the wheat crop here in Kansas could be shipped to Cuba, for instance, as we talked about, and how that makes a difference, how that could raise the tailgate price that every one of us that sells wheat and how that can help us out economically. When it's all about supply and demand from a farmer, and a farmer is a price taker. So if we can raise the price of wheat just a little bit by raising the demand, then that helps every farmer out in this region. And so we have to be educated not only about things here on our farm, but about what's going on in DC, whether it be directly with food safety, food regulations. Maybe it's about our fertilizers that we use or chemicals in order just to cut down on the rules and regulations from an EPA standpoint that we deal with. So there's just so many things that we could talk about on all of those that, you know, we end up going to DC and trying to do an educational basis on them.
So we are a month away from the election. So how does that affect you here on your farm?
Well, there's lots of things that affect us coming into elections with everyone with the uncertainty elections. But part of the thing I'd like to say is, you know, I'm trying to help agriculture out because as through my advocacy work, I am part of the Trump's Agricultural Advisory Board. And so with this, we're able to give input into his candidacy, if he shall win, in order to help agriculture out with all of the rules, regs, the farm prices, the trade, and the embargoes that we've talked about during throughout this interview, in order to help agriculture out for the better.
Thank you, Doug, and thank you for watching this episode. Stay tuned every Friday morning for another episode of That's My Farm.
Closed captioning brought to you by Ag Promo Source. Together we grow. Learn more at agpromosource.com.